These fine gentlemen are researchers hailing from two of the finest research universities in the world, Northeastern and TU Darmstadt. Due to personal financial restrictions, they became interested in inexpensive smart home gear. Let's give a warm welcome to Dennis Giese and Daniel Wegemer.
So thank you very much. And this is Dennis. I'm Daniel, and today we will talk about vacuum cleaners. And to be more specific, we will talk about Xiaomi vacuum cleaners. I already there are some fans over there. I apologize for mispronunciation the name of the vendor. So I actually have no real idea how to pronounce it correctly. So let's start with some numbers. Why did we choose to pay more attention to Xiaomi devices? So they claimed to have 50 million connected devices in 2016, and they also say they made 1.9 million euros in revenue also in 2016. So these are already impressive numbers, but the most or the biggest point for us was that the stuff is actually cheap as hell. When you compare it to other stuff, for example, other vacuum cleaners, which cost 1,000 euro, you can buy four Xiaomi vacuum cleaners for the same amount of money. And yeah, so we choose to look into Xiaomi stuff. And then we saw this advertisement. So they said for their vacuum cleaners, they have three different processors. So three processors. Why do they need three processors in a vacuum cleaner? And our eyes were already like this. So we were really interested to know what is going on in these vacuum cleaners. And then we took a step back and looked into how does the actual ecosystem look like. So in the middle of everything is basically your smartphone app. And then you have, your smart devices. For example, the vacuum cleaners or smart bulbs in the top left corner. There are also smart water kettles or other sensors, which are then connected via a gateway. And I already, or this shows, this arrows here are dotted, and which means that during the connection phase, they talk directly to the smartphone. And then after they are connected, basically they will have a direct connection to the Xiaomi cloud. And yeah, so there's no more communication via the app. They talk directly to the cloud. And as you can see, there are also some other techniques which or protocols they use, for example, Bluetooth LE and Zigbee. So this is already the end of my part, and then Dennis will show you some more in-depth stuff about these vacuum cleaners, and I will just present you this vacuum cleaner. And
thank you, Daniel. So let's take a look at the vacuum cleaner itself. So this is, again, an advertisement, and you see it has a lot of sensors. So the most important one is like this LiDAR sensor, but it also has like a lot of infrared sensors around the device, and which is also very interesting, a gyroscope and accelerometer. So usually you would ask why a device needs that, but it's actually very nice. When we saw that it has a lot of sensors, we thought like, oh yeah, if we can route it, why not? And we tried to a lot of things to route this thing. One approach was like to get some kind of hardware access to that, and the next one was the network-based approach. So it has actually micro USB, so we thought like, oh yeah, so simply connect to the micro USB, what could possibly go wrong? Unfortunately, this doesn't work because we use some kind of authentication for that, so that wasn't possible. The next thing we tried to figure out where some serial port is on the like PCB, but unfortunately we also didn't label that, so we had no idea. Next idea would be, okay, let's connect it to the Wi-Fi and check like for open devices, for open services like Telnet or something. Usually IoT device devices love to have open Telnet ports or Telnet servers. But the thing was, well, port scan wasn't successful, all ports are closed. And our last approach to sniff the network traffic was also not successful because everything is encrypted. So yeah, that was pretty bad. The next thing you usually do is you tear this whole thing down. So basically you unscrew everything and take a look at, you take a look at the whole device. Right, we were very surprised that it was very easy to disassemble this whole thing. And so we think it's also well engineered in terms of you can unplug simply the parts without any connectors or something, so it's very nice. The next thing, what we see here is like the PCB layout. So what you see here is the application processor, which is a quad core, which is an ARM quad core, with 1.5 gigahertz, I think, per core. They're connected is also like 512 megabyte of RAM. It's the DDR3 RAM, if I remember. It has also like 4 gigabyte of flash. And over SDIO, there's some Wi-Fi module, which connects the whole thing to the Wi-Fi. For all the retime tasks, like for example the sensors, there's some STM32 MCU, which takes care of everything like that. And this is ARM Cortex-M3, as probably most of you will know. There's also an additional MCU in the LiDAR, which is not shown here in this picture. So if you look at the backside, you see that there's a lot of test points which are labeled with different marks, like test point 1, test point 2, and everything. Problem with that is it doesn't give us any information about if there's a UART or something. What we figured out was that the only two test points which didn't have a label, they're actually the UART for the application processor. But unfortunately to that, if you connect to that, you don't see anything, so or you can't do anything. So next step, okay, we need to attack the hardware somehow to get root access, and our weapon of our choice was aluminum foil, actually. The idea behind that is actually, so if you look in the data sheet of the application processor, it has some fallback mode, which is called FEL mode. So what we did is we inserted the aluminum foil under the BGA chip and shortcutted the MMC data lines. So the application processor fall back in this FEL mode. And then we can connect through USB and upload some small tool, which then dumps the complete memory content of the MMC flash. As soon as we had the MMC flash, we could do some modifications to that. We didn't have any checks, runtime checks on like certificates or whatever. And then reflash it again to the chip. Fun thing about that is exactly one layer of aluminum foil fits under the chip. Two are too much, actually. So you need just one. The idea is just to corrupt the data. As soon as we take a look into that vacuum image, vacuum cleaner image, actually, we figured out that we use actually Ubuntu 14.04, which was mostly untouched in terms of the packages were still original. And we do a lot of patching on a really regular base. For example, we closed down the vulnerability for the VPA quite fast. For navigation, we use open source software called Player, which takes care of all the sensors. And we have, of course, like also a lot of like proprietary software which do the cloud communication or like the control of the commands which come from the cloud. One thing which we figured out is actually behind the USB, we have some ADB running, but the ADB do some custom authentication things. So you basically you need information which you usually don't have to access that port, and so that's not possible to get onto the vacuum. And then most interesting is also like the way we run SSH, but the SSH is blocked by IP tables, so they close down also that thing. So actually not that bad, technically. Right. So let's take a quick look at the data on the device. Apparently, we love to create log files. There are a lot of log files. For example, we collect syslog files, we collect durations for cleaning jobs, the area which we're driving around, but also like important data like SSID and passwords. Fun thing is, we're in some binaries, there's this line with TCP dump. Now the big question is why we need that. I don't know. You can think the rest. Right. And for all of you who have like some kind of LTE with volume-based, stuff. This vacuum, if it's just stand around, it creates a lot of data already. So it's multiple megabytes per day. If you run it for cleaning, it creates even more data. So basically, if you have LTE, then probably you have a big interest to, route this device. And also maps. Maps I will tell later in one second. So all this data is uploaded to the cloud, so the vendor has it. And another important thing is, if you do a factory reset, the operation system is restored from a recovery, but the data, like the maps and the logs, are not deleted. So basically, we are still on a vacuum cleaner. So if you reset your vacuum cleaner, sell it on Amazon, then the next owner of the vacuum will know your SSID and password and how your apartment looks like. Talking about apartments look like, this is how the maps look onto the device. So basically, this open source player software creates this kind of maps. Technically, they are bitmaps, 1024 pixels in square, and one pixel is more or less equivalent to 5 centimeters. One thing is the LiDAR is way more precise, but they just store like 5 centimeters in terms of like accuracy. Right. Before we take a look at the communication itself, we want to take a look at the configuration. So one thing which is quite usual for all of the Xiaomi devices is that every device has its unique device ID, which is burned at the factory, more or less, into the device. For the vacuum cleaner, it's a text file, so technically you can edit it, but for other devices, it's like in UTP memory. And they have two kinds of keys, a cloud key, which is just used for the cloud communication and it's never changed, and a token, which is only used for the app communication and is changed every time if you reset the vacuum or connect it to complete new Wi-Fi. So I know that there are a lot of like attacks outside there who try to control the vacuum cleaner over this token, but every time you connect it to your new Wi-Fi, the token is regenerated, so you have to start from the beginning again. Right. This is just for a few information about that. So if you take a very simple look at the cloud communication, everything here in this left box is actually the internal of the vacuum cleaner. So you have a lot of like processes inside which take care of the navigation. And the most central one is the Mio client, which takes care of all the communication between inside and outside. So So here we have some examples. So if the cloud wants you to do something, it sends you a message which is encrypted, obviously, with the cloud key. Then this Mio client decrypts it and forwards it in plain text JSON to the internal devices, which then communicate over, for example, IPC between each other. And the result of that thing is, again, forwarded inside the vacuum with plain text, but then as soon as it exits the vacuum, it's encrypted again. So all the time you see something, it's encrypted. Also, if you download it like firmwares or upload map files, then it's everything is also encrypted with HTTPS, as you see on the cloud side at the top right. Okay, let's take a quick look at the update process itself. So what we do is actually, so we need my laser again. They send from the cloud an encrypted package with the package information. So the cloud tells the vacuum where it has to download the firmware. So we give them the URL. And the next thing they do is they give also the MD5 of the URL. So let's say something goes wrong by the download of the file, then the vacuum can check, like, OK, is the MD5 OK? So you can attack that very easily. The next thing that happens is that the vacuum wants to download it. We show here the some simple simplified structure of the memory. So you have technically two copies of the operation system, one active copy and one passive copy. You probably know that from all of the IoT devices, because it's quite usual for all devices that we have at least two copies of the operation system. So the Vacuum downloads the package, then checks in the next step if the MD5 is okay, which was transmitted in an encrypted channel from the cloud. If that's okay, it uses some secret key to decrypt this package, and it unpacks that to some temporary partition. Next thing, this is quite important, they update the root password. So basically every device has a different root password, which you don't know actually. So not a master password for all of the devices. And the next thing is it updates the passive partition. After this is done, the Vacuum takes some time to rethink and reboot, and it reboots the new updated partition. And in the next step, they update the old active partition again. So after that, you have a completely updated Vacuum cleaner with the newest version. Right. So the thing is, well, how does firmware updates look like actually? And there are two kinds of firmware updates. One firmware update is like full and the other is partial. They encrypt the TAR-GZ archives. And most of the time they contain, so the full image contains the disk image, which has the full file system for the Linux. The fun thing is they weren't very creative in the password for the encryption, which is RockRobo. And the next fun thing is you can download also sound files on the Vacuum, and it uses a more complex password than this one. So they protect their sound files better than the firmware updates. The firmware update is encrypted with AES, with Secrypt, which is a standard Linux tool. And the integrity is more or less protected by the cloud, because the cloud tells you before that what the MD5 is look like. Right. So now we know the password for the firmware, and we get this firmware somewhere. We can prepare our root, and this time we simply take the firmware and rebuild it. For example, we include our authorized key file for SSH, so we can log in with SSH, and we remove the IP tables rule for that, so that the SSH is not protected by IP tables anymore. The next thing that we can do is we can send the update command ourselves with the URL of our own web server and the MD5 of our own file. And the good thing is that the Vacuum cleaner accepted this command if we encrypted with the token. So basically, the token you can somehow get the token somewhere from the app, for example, and then we can send this this update command. It takes a few minutes, so like I think between 5 and 10 minutes. And after that, what you can do is you can log in into that thing. Like I said before, it's Ubuntu, so you can do apt-get update and install your own software onto that, and like run like HTOP or something. The next interesting thing is you can also access directly the sensors. So for example, here I have some map data which is created by the LiDAR sensor. Right, now we have the root access onto that device. Then we want to gain independence from the cloud. We have two methods actually. It depends more or less if you want to still be, if you want to be still able to use the app from them. So the more drastic one is to replace simply the cloud interface, and the other one is like to proxy the cloud communication. So if you want to get rid of the cloud completely, so what you can do is you simply take the Mio client and install your like own client. It could be some small Python script which do some external commands like from FEM or Home Assistant. It's very easy to do that. And to get rid of the map upload, you simply use a host file which simply kills all the Xiaomi servers. Very easy, but the problem is now the app doesn't work anymore. But it's very simple, actually. The other thing would be like to proxy the cloud communication. For that, we developed some open source implementation of the Xiaomi cloud, which we call Dust Cloud. And it basically is a complete emulation. So what you can do is you can actually forward even packets to the real cloud, or you can simply use it like as a local cloud solution, or like even forward change commands, suppress them completely. Like usually you want to suppress firmware updates. That kind of stuff you don't want to send outside. Let's get inside. So this is some way what you can do, and we publish also this thing on our GitHub. Right, some use cases. You can use this whole thing as a home automation server. You can use it also as a web radio, and or even as a file server. But the file server problem is actually so the usable memory is like 2 GB more or less. So it's not a very big file server. But the good thing is, if you have a power outage, this thing holds for 2 days with the battery. So it's a great thing. I know that the question would come like, oh, can I use it for Bitcoin mining? I think nowadays it's a little bit difficult. It has 2 GPUs. Which I used somehow, but I think they're too slow nowadays. So, sorry. But if you hack millions of them, maybe. Okay. For the home automation server, we have some sample firmware where we installed FEM into the vacuum cleaner, and you see here that we can run it more or less locally. We know the token because we can access it directly, and then you can run your home automation system directly on the vacuum cleaner. No need for a Raspberry Pi. Everything runs very smoothly. We have some downloadable content for you, but we are not EA, but we demand money for that, so it's free. We have modified some firmware for you, so you can download them and install that. You can download also the our cloud emulation. But the thing is, I'm not a very good Python programmer, so basically it's totally broken and insecure, so don't use it for productive means and don't put it on the internet, maybe. I'm also very happy if someone can take a look at that. And we also will publish pictures, pinouts, and much more. Everything under the domain donevacuum.me. Yeah, so we upload this thing like today in the evening or so after the talk is over and we have time. Right. So we have two things we want to mention. Actually, two words of warning, not one. Never leave your devices unprovisioned. So we know a lot of people, or some people, who some professor even, who thought like, oh, I don't trust the cloud, so I simply don't connect the vacuum to the Wi-Fi. That might be a bad idea because they have an open Wi-Fi access point, the vacuum cleaners. So what someone can do for you is like it can provision that thing for you and can install like malicious firmware or even snoop your apartment. So always provision your device. And the second thing is be very careful with used devices. So bad people could like order that kind of devices on Amazon and send them back after they put something onto that. And if you do it for very, very expensive devices like Roomba for 1,000 euros, then there could be some assumption what kind of people would buy this kind of stuff. So, you know, it could be very, never mind, bad ideas. All right, and that's more or less the end of our presentation. So we want to thank two people, more or less, or more people, the Semo Lab at the TU Darmstadt and Professor Nubir from the Northeastern University. And now we are happy to take your questions about our talk. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dennis and Daniel. So if you have questions for Dennis and or Daniel, please line up by one of the microphones. There are 4 over here, 1, 2, 3, 4. There are 4 over there, 5, 6, 7, 8. And from the internet, one of our signal angels will be reading your questions aloud on your behalf. So, let's see. Any questions for the Xiaomi vacuum hacking? Signal Angel, do we have a question from the internet?
Not yet.
Not yet. Microphone number 2.
Test, test. Hi, thank you for your talk. How many robots were harmed doing the research?
So in total, I bought like 9 of them. And also work, so it's just a 100% chance of like successful routing. So yeah, no brick ones. Yeah.
Microphone number 6.
Hi. So you said what the robot is doing when I have it in my Wi-Fi? It's sniffing all the traffic and uploading it to the cloud.
Hello. Hello. Okay. So there is at least a cloud command which Xiaomi can, for example, send to your vacuum, which then enables monitor mode and enables this TCP sniffing, TCP dump sniffing. So we don't exactly know why there would be some kind of command like this, but we saw at least the string and we know that there is this command. We did not investigate further into this up until this point. So.
Okay. So the logs are just there, but they're not sent by default.
No. So they need to send the command for this to start and so on. Yeah.
Okay. But the logs are uploaded all the time. So the logs are uploaded, but it doesn't mean that the PCAP file was there. So logs are always uploaded, but the PCAP file have to be created by the command.
Hi. Have you looked at any other Xiaomi devices besides this robot?
Yeah. So test. Is this working? Yeah. Okay. So yep. This is sort of spoilers, but yes, we did. For example, we looked into light bulbs, smart light bulbs, and we were also able to route these kind of devices. Or let's say we were able to get them into your own cloud, if you want to say so. And we will present this work at Recon at the beginning of February.
Yes. Did you try to modify your robot software and install your own software, maybe your robot operating system there?
So your question is if we have total root access to the vacuum, we can install everything. Mm-hmm. And the player software is actually open source. It's also used for different kinds of other robots, and it's just the standard open source version, which they also use basically to communicate with the sensors of the robot. Yeah. Was this your question?
Yeah, I didn't also understand it, so I'm just was curious.
Yeah. You mentioned you had ADPD running on USB. Did you try to reverse the authentication they implemented on that custom installation?
Yeah, so we tried actually. So we figured out that you need some strings like the like some kind of root password, which you usually don't have, which usually the vendor probably has in its database. So they did it quite well. So the authentication is not that trivial. Actually, it's even have multiple levels. So you have to, even if you have one level, you need to gain another level. So it's like it's way easier to after you rooted this device, it's to install your the open source ADB software. So you can simply connect USB and do ADB shell. So if you have once you have that as a recovery method for the vacuum, you can do that. But to reverse the authentication. Of the ADB of the custom ADB, it's way too hard actually.
So it just accepts a hashed version of a password for the ADBD, or
it's some kind of challenge response what we do.
Okay.
And if you even did the first level of the challenge response, there's a second level, and I think there's even a third level if you want to get a shell or whatever. So it's like a game.
All right. Thank you.
Did you disclose this to Xiaomi before? Because I just got a bug release update for my vacuum.
No, we didn't. And the reason is because we don't want Xiaomi to close down this bug. I mean, it's not a real bug, but you know, the thing is, as soon as your vacuum is rooted, and as soon as you have the cloud encryption key, they cannot do anything anymore because you can read all the communication, you can get all the firmware updates, you can send your own firmware updates to the vacuum. So as soon as you have the key, you're more or less protected against the firmware updates of Xiaomi. But the problem is, if you buy now a vacuum cleaner and they change something in their firmware that it doesn't work anymore, then we have to start from the beginning again, or you have to use aluminum foil. Because against this attack, I think it's very hard to somehow, for the chip at least, what we use, it's very hard to defend against that. But it's not very, so if you have the choice to remotely update your vacuum with your own firmware, please don't use the aluminum foil, because bad things can happen in terms of you miss one pin, and then you put some 5 volts onto the MMC, and you know, if you have no idea what to do, you better don't do the aluminum foil thing. Yeah.
Thank you.
Could you use that approach to make the robots, make multiple robots work together?
Yes, so the player software, I think the player software is supported by default. So basically, we use the player software to control the small robots to do some collaborative thing, I guess, if I remember correctly. Yeah, so.
So your rule of the device, you can do anything you want, so.
Yeah.
Hi, thanks for the talk. And how did you get the passwords, like RobRobo, or how do you know that the voice packages have a better password?
Well, we reverse engineered the binaries, and the fun thing was that they have still all the debug symbols in that, because they thought, why remove the debug symbols? And it was very easy to get the strings. It was simply somewhere a string, and it was in the near of the decrypt command, and there was this RobRobo thing. First, we didn't thought that it's a password, because it was too easy. But after we had the password for the audio files, then we looked deeper in this thing, and then we figured out that RobRobo is for real the password. So basically, you're reverse engineering of the binaries itself.